Let me tell you about the time that I found out I was pregnant with triplets. Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. It's your girl Selena, and I'm going to be doing a story time of the time that I found out that I was pregnant with triplets. Not one baby, not two babies, three babies. So stick around. It was back in the year 2013. I had just found out that I was pregnant. I did a whole pregnancy test. And I had a 10-month-old at the time. So when I found out that I was pregnant, I made a doctor appointment to go see how far along I was. And I wasn't sweating it because I had a baby like 10 months ago during that time. So I wasn't worried about it going to see the doctor. So when it came time for my appointment, I went alone. I've been through it before. So I went to my appointment. And I remember laying down flat on the bed so that the lady can do a, dang, how many weeks that was? I think I was 8 weeks during that time. The doctor was doing a sonogram on my belly. I remember before I did go to that appointment, I felt like I was showing already. I'm like, why my belly so big? Of course, I didn't think it was multiples in there. With my pudge, I was laying down on the bed. And the doctor put the sonogram on my belly, and I'm sitting there waiting to find out what the gender is and how big the baby is. And so she, you know, she's doing her thing, taking her time. And then all of a sudden, she just turned off her machine. She just left. I'm like, what the hell? Like, where did she go? She didn't say anything to me. She just left. So I'm here thinking, having an anxiety attack, thinking something wrong with my baby. She's not telling me nothing. She was gone for a whole 30 minutes. I sat in that room, nobody came in, and I'm just sitting there. I kid you not, I was so afraid. My heart was beating so fast. I didn't know what to think because I'm thinking she didn't find no heartbeat, no anything. So she left me there 30 minutes, and then she finally came in, and she came in with somebody else. And as soon as she came in, I bombarded her with questions like, is there something wrong with my baby? Like, why didn't you say anything to me? She just left. Had me sitting there stressing that whole time. She turned the machine back on, did the sonogram again, and that's when she told me that she found three heartbeats. She found three heartbeats. And she showed me. What? I have nothing to say. Like I was speechless. I couldn't find no words. I didn't know if this was real. Maybe it was a dream. Honey, I was I didn't know what to think. It didn't seem real to me. How can three babies be in my belly? I didn't do nothing. Well, I like to tell people I was asleep when I got pregnant. But I didn't do anything special. Like, how the heck can I have three babies in me? So what it is, I'm out here shooting out three eggs at a time when I'm ovulating? I mean, it's unheard of. I've never even met nobody who had triplets in their life. And to find that I had three babies in my belly, I was speechless. Nobody was there with me either. And when I seen the sonogram with all three babies on it, it still, even now, it still feels unreal to me. I remember them taking me to a different room to talk to another doctor. And that doctor was explaining to me how this is gonna be a really high risk pregnancy and that I would need to be monitored very closely, possibly every single week. And of course, I'm still speechless. Like, I still had no worries at that time, like, what the heck is going on? But what really scared me was when they showed me the sonogram, the second doctor that I was talking to, he was really concerned about one of the babies because you can hardly see him in there, but he was still there. So they really wanted to keep a close eye on the third baby. They gave me an appointment so I could see a high-risk doctor at a different facility. And when I walked out of that clinic, I remember seeing all those people waiting in the waiting room, And I looked over at them and I stopped, like, in my head now. Do y'all know what just happened to me? In my head. I still didn't, I couldn't really speak. I could not speak at all. Like, I am still stunned at this time. I remember going all the way to Randy's job. I hadn't told nobody yet. The first person I need to tell was Randy. So I remember going to Randy's job and I finally saw him and I told him, listen, they found 3 heartbeats in my belly. We're having triplets. And he thought I was playing at first. He thought I was playing a prank on him. But I had that sonogram. When I showed him that sonogram, I'm like, listen, man, we having 3 babies at once. He was surprised. He was stunned as well. I mean, that's crazy. Who has news like that? I think I called my mom after that. After I left Randy, I would call my mom and I told her about that as well. And then I went towards my family house. And when I got in there, all the family members that was there in the living room, I remember walking in, everybody started clapping and yelling. I felt like it was a parade. Like, I ain't do nothing. But it did make me feel good to see my family celebrating. It's something that's rare, I guess, to conceive triplets naturally. That's crazy. So I completely skipped twins. I mean, I went straight for the triplets. Thank God it wasn't quadruplets. So for the pregnancy, it took some getting used to. I was seeing a doctor, of course, every single week. They was monitoring the babies. I was surprised on one thing, though. I felt nauseous, but I never really had, like, really bad morning sickness, like, at all. And what was so crazy was, whenever I was really hungry, I could only eat just a little bit, but then maybe another hour later, I'll be hungry. So I stayed hungry a lot, but I couldn't eat a whole lot of food at once because I barely even had any room. But then there was a time where we got a sonogram done, and I can't remember how many weeks I was, but the tech, when she was doing the sonogram on my belly, she noticed something. She pulled me and Randy into a different room to talk to us about something that they found along with the baby. So I'm like, oh, here we go. What's wrong now? Like, I knew this pregnancy couldn't be easy. I mean, I knew it couldn't be smooth running. There's always going to be some problems that you run into when you have so many. And the lady said, you have something that is called TTTS. That's what I had. So I had two boys and I had one girl. And she told me that the two boys were identical twins. TTTS only develops in babies that are identical twins, that they share a placenta. And when she explained to me what happened was one baby, which was baby C wasn't growing much. He had a little bit of fluid around him, and then baby B, he had a lot of fluid around him and he was growing too big. So when you have one baby that's taking basically all the nutrients and stuff from the one baby, the baby C was not much to really thrive on. So it was going to be a very risky pregnancy on top of there being 3, because babies with TTTS normally do not survive. And of course, I was worried as heck because we never heard of something like that before. And I was scared because there was a possibility that I could lose not only 2 babies, I can lose baby A, which was my little girl. So she told me there was a possibility that I could terminate baby C so that baby B can thrive and baby A would also survive. That gave us a whole lot to think about. I didn't think I really had much option. But then we got a phone call about another option. This option was to go to another state to possibly do surgery on the fetus to help save the babies. They were gonna do surgery on my belly during this time. While the baby's in my belly, like, could you believe that? I had never heard of that either. Like, how do you have surgery on the babies inside of my belly? But it was a way. And it was called the Cincinnati Children's Hospital. I believe that's what the hospital was called. We got booked for a flight to fly out to Ohio and to go to the Children's Hospital and see what they can do for our babies, because we didn't want to terminate one. I wanted to keep all 3. Baby C was much smaller than the other 2, so I wanted to do everything I possibly can to save them.
I didn't want to lose them. So I remember when we got our plane tickets, we got on the plane, right? I mean, that was my second time getting on the plane. We made it to our hotel, and what made the trip such a blessing is that the foundation, the TTTS Foundation, reached out to us, and they basically paid for almost everything. They paid for food, they paid for our stay while we was in Cincinnati, but they paid for a lot of things, and they also hooked us up with the Ronald McDonald's, where you get to stay, you go back and forth to the hospital, they provide food for you. It was amazing. That foundation did so good to us. To thank this foundation, it was amazing, and I'm very thankful for everything they did for our family during that time. So when we made it to the hospital, and I remember going inside of a big old room, and we were sitting down with doctors. Wait, before we went into that room, they did do another sonogram on my belly so they can take a look at, you know, what was happening, what it is they need to deal with. And then from there, we went to a big room with a lot of doctors in the room, and we just sitting thinking, what's gonna happen? Is my baby gonna be okay? When will I do the surgery? Will the surgery hurt? And what does it look like for my other two babies? I mean, it was a whole lot of nerves during that time. I remember one of the doctors said, baby C fluid has increased. His fluid increased, which means that's a good sign that he could possibly survive and we may not need to do the surgery. I can't remember how much fluid we had going to Cincinnati, but that last sonogram that I did before we left, he wasn't doing so good. But for some reason, his fluid was starting to get better. And so the doctor decided and they determined at that time, we don't need to do the surgery. And boy, was I happy. I cried. I cried because that situation turned around just like that. The surgery on its own was gonna be very risky. All I kept hearing were, well, there's a possibility of losing all three of your babies while doing the surgery. And then there's a possibility of losing all of the babies if you don't do the surgery. And it's like all I heard. And to find out that baby C fluid was steadily increasing, it blew my mind. And I felt like it was a miracle. I feel like my baby is a miracle baby. It's like he's not supposed to be here right now, but he made it. And he kept pulling through. So I didn't get the surgery. He was doing so good to where I didn't get the surgery. We went home without any of the babies having to be touched. And so he got better and he got better. And it was looking pretty good. I remember all my friends and family came and did like this big baby shower for me. I had tons of stuff, tons of things. And everybody was just so supportive. They, especially my family, boy, I love my family to death. They did an amazing job by helping support us during that time. And then we had to move in a bigger place because the apartment that we were living in, we only had, a one bedroom. So we moved into a bigger apartment because how was going to fit all these babies in there? He has a lot of babies. And then having to shop, like when we shopped, we had to shop for three. I was like, Jesus. I remember buying three bassinets. Whole lot of diapers. I mean, it was a lot of things to buy, and we also had a lot of support from outside people who was willing to help us out with anything. So the goal that the doctors set for us was they wanted the babies to stay in my belly as long as possible, so I was on bed rest, which meant I couldn't work, I couldn't do too much shopping, running around. I had to basically just stay home, stay in the bed, stay on the couch, just don't do too much because our goal is to let the baby stay in as long as possible so that they can have, I would say, a better life, because babies that are born early, you know, they have problems. They wanted everything to be developed as much as possible before they came out. The doctor started seeing me twice a week now, and when I say my belly was growing my belly was growing. It was so heavy and it was also very dark too. It was always so hard to walk, and I remember my feet being so swollen whenever I did go to the grocery store. Okay, sometimes I went to the grocery store and I had to get on the little carts that they have at Walmart, and I used to push myself around. I used to hate it though, because I wanted to walk and I felt so lazy. I felt really lazy, but of course I had to stay off my feet, and I did want to go to the store. I mean, being cooped up in the house was annoying as heck. But the babies were safe. I didn't do too much and didn't go too far. Joshua was still the smallest baby, but he was still hanging on there. He had a place in his world. He wasn't going nowhere. And it was one night, I woke up and I felt like a pinch. What the heck was that? And I felt it internally. Felt like that was nothing. It was nothing. So I tried to go back to sleep, but I couldn't. And I'm thinking to myself, I hope I make it to at least 32 weeks. Because I was 30, I believe I was either 28 or I think I was 28 or 30 weeks along. And I was sitting in the bed, and when I sat up, stuff started coming out on the bed. Like, I was bleeding. And I'm like, oh my God, my water broke. My water broke. We rushed to the hospital, they got us checked in. Then they checked the babies and they checked me, and they didn't find anything wrong. Like, I wasn't contracting or anything like that. They checked me and said, your water didn't break, so it's nothing to be concerned about, and they wanted to send me home. I was like, I definitely saw, I mean, something did come out, and I could have sworn I was in labor. So we was getting packed. Almost everybody was in their room. Everybody was there because I thought I was going to be having my babies. We got all packed up and we were on our way to leave. But before we left the room, I felt something come out again. I'm like, wait a minute now, there's more fluid stuff coming out. Something's wrong. Like, imagine if I would have went home, what would happen to the babies? We went back in the room, we told the doctor, and they came back in. And it was like, every which way that I moved, like, it's a certain way that I move is when the fluid comes out. So baby A, which is a girl, baby A was the one that was closer to my bottom area. Her water didn't break. Well, her amniotic sac didn't break. So that's what they were seeing. They didn't see that baby B, his sac broken, and he was the one that was ready to come out. I stayed in the bed. The doctors finally confirmed that we're gonna be having triplets. We're gonna be having the babies that day. So they got me all prepped up, they got me ready. They did everything they need to do so they can prep me for the C-section. Now, I wasn't gonna have them vaginally, not at all, no. So they did emergency C-section on me. I remember laying on that bed and hearing the first cry. That was an amazing sound. Hearing the first baby come out and hearing them cry. Like, when you hear your baby cry, it just does something to your insides. It makes you feel warm. It makes you feel like your baby is okay and they're healthy when you hear a really strong cry out. Jasmine was baby A. She was the first one to come out. And then second was baby C. Baby C was the second one to come out. And that one was Joshua, my really, really small baby. And then there was Justin. He was the last baby to come out, even though he's baby B. Hearing all of their cries, one of the best sounds I've ever heard in my life. I remember when we was in that room, they had like three, I would say baby beds for each child. And just to see all that stuff ready and prepared for babies that are coming out of me, that was just crazy. So all the babies was out. They put me in recovery. I didn't see the babies at all. Like, everyone else got to see the baby. They had to rush them to the NICU. They had to rush the babies to the NICU because they were preemies. They was really, really small. So they rushed them to the NICU and they put me in recovery room where I sat for a couple of hours to recover. And I hadn't seen the babies. I hadn't seen their faces. I hadn't seen anything. And when I got out of the recovery room, they took me to my room where I was going to be staying for a couple of days. It was there while I was trying to get as much breast as I possibly could. And they was also bringing a breast pump for me to try to pump as much milk as I can to help the babies, because, you know, breast milk is the healthiest milk you can give the babies. And especially with them being preemies, breast milk was just going to do them a whole lot better. So when the babies was in the NICU, they had a feeding tube. They had a feeding tube put in, and they didn't need any oxygen because they was breathing on their own, which was a surprise. I'm like, thank God they was breathing on their own. I remember trying to pump as much milk as I possibly can to get to the babies, and it was like the next day. And I remember sitting in that hospital bed and I was crying because it had been a whole day. Everybody had seen the babies but me. Like, I haven't seen them. I felt like people was trying to keep me from my kids. Like, let me see my babies. Like, everybody has seen these kids but me. I was finally able to go see the kids. We went down to the NICU, and when I seen them, they were so small, especially Joshua. I'm gonna show you a picture if you haven't already. I'm gonna be showing you a picture of how his leg was all the way up on his chest. But he was just so small. I mean, could you imagine such small babies? It was just so crazy to see that those little babies was inside of me. And they finally made it out. They were breathing on their own. They had a body of their own. And they were hooked up to all these machines. And it was like in a warmer to keep them warm. They had the blankets on. And me and Randy felt like one of the nurses was so stingy with Izzy because she was always by Izzy. She didn't want nobody to touch Izzy. I'm like, oh, can I at least touch her? Can I touch her finger or something? They stayed in the NICU for 30 days. Joshua needed to stay a little bit longer, so the other two left before he did. He stayed, what, maybe 2 days later. I would go in the NICU and I would try to breastfeed the babies. At this time, I was only trying to breastfeed one. And we were trying to get the babies to latch on. Their mouth was so little, it was hard for them to latch on my big old bosoms. But they finally was able to have a good suction to get the milk out, and it was just so adorable. And I remember we was in the newspaper, like, I guess the news journal got caught wind of us having triplets, and they came out to the hospital. They wanted to do an article on us, and they wanted to take pictures with all the babies on me, along with the other part of my family. But y'all was trying to hold the babies all at once, and they trying to take a picture. And so they got the article written, and they got the picture of us. But the babies finally came home. The first couple of weeks we had to sleep downstairs, and thank God we had a futon. We needed to watch the babies. Like, I was too scared to put them in the room by themselves. We have a whole lot of room downstairs in the living room, so we slept on the futon. And the three bassinets was right next to us, and feeding time was crazy, man. Imagine trying to feed three babies at once, to hear them all cry at once, feed them at once. Everybody needed changing. We had to do one at a time when it comes down to the changing part. I fed one baby, Randy fed one baby, and then when one baby was done, put that baby down. Well, of course, burping. Put that baby down, get the third baby, feed that baby satisfied, and it was on clockwork. Sleep? Sleep where? Sleep who? Ain't nobody get no sleep. My family did come over sometimes to help us out. Sometimes they brought us food, sometimes they came to help the babies, help change the babies, help feed the babies. Everybody wanted to see the babies and be there. Listen, I need help. Help me. So yeah, we stayed downstairs in the living room for a while. When all the babies was finally home, that first day when all three of them was home, I was scared. I didn't know what to do. And I remember the doctor, the NICU doctor, had called me to make sure everything was okay. And I'm like, what do I do? Like, I don't know how to take care of three babies. I was, like, my mind went blank, even though I had a toddler. I didn't know what I was doing. I'm like, I'm going to have to take care of these babies. It hit me late. I'm going to have to take care of these babies. I'm going to have to make sure they fed. I'm going to have to make sure that they're changed and put them on clothes and hold them. After I hung up that phone call, we just did it. But you just do. You just you take care of them. You take one step at a time. If the baby's hungry, feed him. Once you're done feeding him, hurt him so that he don't throw up. The baby needs to be changed, change him. Put him on some clothes so they can be nice and warm. And he has some pretty nice to wear. And you just did that over and over and over again. And you're basically, you're taking care of the child. When the baby was home, was whenever we fed, especially Izzy, she threw up a lot, a whole lot. And when she did throw up, she held her mouth shut and all the throw up came out of her nose. So she couldn't breathe. That was scary as heck. When I saw that, I panicked. Like, my baby cannot breathe. She is basically choking on her own vomit. And so what I did to help that was, I got so scared, I put my hand in her mouth to open up her mouth to let her know she can breathe, like to force air out of her mouth. And she did that a lot. And all the throw up was coming out of her nose. She could not breathe, and it happened often. I was so scared to leave them, to go anywhere, because what if it happened while I was asleep? I was so afraid for so long. And then it was happening to Izzy at one time. And then it started to happen to Justin and Joshua, all three of them was throwing up, but they clamped down on their mouths. And then the throw up came out of their nose and they could not breathe and they were struggling. So I almost cried. I was trying my best to help and get my hands in at least two of their mouths and that Randy to try to get the third one. I'm like, I can't do this. But thank God they grew out of that. Oh, thank God, because I don't think no parent should experience that. I don't know why that happened. I remember we had to get like this long stroller that fit all three of the babies at once. And we used to take them to school in that big bulky triplet stroller. And I remember going to their school and taking them out and putting them back in again and taking that big old stroller to the store whenever we went to the store. And I remember taking them to their doctor's appointments and having to carry. So I had two carriers on one arm and the third carrier on the other arm. And having to change all the babies when we go to that doctor's appointment so that they can be looked at and they can be fresh. Baby, that was a time then. The triplets are now 10 years old. We got Izzy, Joshua, and Justin. And let me tell you something that had me confused. I'm still confused about it. So remember when I told you guys that Justin and Joshua had TTTS, twin to twin syndrome? That only happens with identical twins. But if you look at Joshua and Justin now, they're not identical twins. They look like they're fraternal twins. So how could they have had twin to twin syndrome when they're fraternal? They look like fraternal twins, but the doctors confirmed that they shared the same sac, which is identical twins. So how can you have identical twins that look completely different? Joshua is he's shorter, he's skinnier, and Justin is darker, taller, and huskier. It was even like that in my belly, I know, but how does that happen? Like, did somebody make a mistake? And I'm still confused about that. I'm going to be wondering that for the rest of my life, I believe. But it's all good. I'm not complaining. So yeah, the kids are now 10 years old. They are in the fourth grade. They're healthy kids now, and all they do is fight. Joshua and Justin, they fight over everything. You can have 100 Legos right here, and then you have one blue Lego way over there. They're not gonna fight for the big amount. They're gonna fight over that one blue Lego. They fight over everything. It don't matter what it is, they're gonna fight over it. But then, by the end of the night, they're gonna be right there next to each other, sleeping. They have to be close to each other when they sleep. Like, don't care how much they fight. Don't care how much they try to bruise each other up or say mean things to each other. They're gonna be right there next to each other when they sleep. Even though they have their own beds, they're gonna sleep right next to each other. It's as if they're still in the womb. They are right there. Then there's Izzy. That's my shmaybe. Izzy and Joshua fight, then they fight, and then they fight. Listen, all them kids do is fight, but they good. And of course, I do want to show you some videos and pictures of everything that went down during my pregnancy. I do have some pregnancy photos too, of how big my belly got. I have videos of the babies in the NICU. Which is, I got a lot of videos, and I do want to show you guys our journey along the way with all the pictures and videos that I have. We have a lot.
Mama, this is, it's easy to get ready to go home.
You go ahead.
Put that one on.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're not going for matching right now.
And it's just two forms that they sign. Yeah. Mom, no, she's the regular bracelet. She has that one off, right? And then,
are we shining yet? Oh, yeah, you are. You wake up, mommy. Wake up, baby. You wake up for your mommy, so I say so. You don't hide your face. I want to see your face. Mommy, I want to see it. Yeah, see. You want to hide for mommy? Mommy, I'll give you lollipop. Mommy, I can give it to you.
You can't see nothing on there. It's so dark. Glass.
I'm going to delete it, though. Jacka Izzy. You happy Thanksgiving, mommy. You happy Thanksgiving. Happy Thanksgiving, mommy and daddy. Yeah, I said sure wrapped up in the covers. I said sure wrapped up. Say happy Thanksgiving, my first Thanksgiving, mommy and daddy. Hey, baby, that Izzy was her name, oh. That Izzy. You wake up, mommy. You wake up. Lace up, baby. Your brother over there up. You gonna let him beat you up? Mm. You wish up for you, for your family. Mommy, why you? Mommy, daddy, why you, baby? Say hey, Yoshi. Say hey, mommy. And mommy, Ayashi. And mommy, Ayashi, and I'm about to eat. Okay, daddy, eat. This is my day. Say, Jasmine and Justin already ate from mommy's breast. Now it's my turn. I'm gonna be a big boy and I'm gonna eat from mommy. Say, eat. You open your mouth to mommy, honey. You honey, baby. You honey. Mommy is for you, okay?
Justin, oops.
Is it Justin going home from the ICU?
Say bye-bye all the monitors and stuff. Bye-bye. Say bye-bye, Yoshi. Yeah, we come back get you, okay? I'm going to come back get that baby. Uh-oh. Say bye-bye. We come back get you, baby, okay? When we come back get you.
Yep, going home with mommy. We going home with mommy. We got cold. We all got behind. Got to go home to Jeremiah.
One, two, three.
That's Justin. That's Isabella. That's Joshua. Say hello. Hello, baby. Oh, wow.
I'm gonna tell mommy we're gone.
What are you doing over there, Justin? What are you doing? You all peaceful, baby. Hey, Yashi. Yeah, mommy, who are you?
Less wings and some.
Uh-oh. Dad got the hiccups, mommy. Dad got the hiccups. Come on, baby. Say hey, everybody. Say hey, Yashi. Hey, mommy, I'm fussing. Mommy, I'm fussing. Read you bad. Why are you gonna tell mommy what won? Here is Dustin. Say hey, Dustin. Say hello. Say hey, everybody. I'm a big boy now. Yeah, I'm bigger than both of my sister and my brother.
Give everybody a thumbs up. Okay.
There's my sister. Say, there go Isabella.
There go Isabella swinging. Say, hey, mommy. Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody.
Justin? Justin?
Justin?
Get our shots. There you go, so your brother stopped eating your arm.
Should have been writing this stuff down when she was talking. That's what I told myself. Bring a notepad so you can write it. You just got this photo book memory that I don't know nobody got.
I wish I would do it.
Hey y'all, we're getting big.
We on camera. Hey Julie, we on camera. Wayne. Hey Joshua.
Bryce, no. Bryce, let him play with it. He's already there.
Jeremiah, stop. No.
All right, guys, y'all ready to say happy birthday? 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jasmine, Joshua, Justin, and Juliet. Happy birthday to you.
Blow it out, guys. Blow it, Julie. Blow the candle, Julie. Blow the candle, Julie.
Yay.
Good job. Let's see the cake, Juliet. Happy birthday, three.
Hey guys. Hey guys. Hey Jemima. Where are we at? The zoo?
Yeah. No.
I do hope you guys enjoyed this video, this story time of how I found out I was pregnant with triplets. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next. You gotta go.